saw for the very first time at the cross. My dark world was suddenly illuminated. I mean, I've been seeing, but I hadn't really been seeing, if you catch my drift. That's actually how I was living, drifting. But at the cross, where Jesus laid his life down, I came to a magnificent realization. I was bought with blood. Check the receipt and you will see compassion. Above compassion, you will see mercy. And above mercy, you will see love. I was bought with blood. The only righteous man to ever live was unrighteously murdered so I could be righteous in him. He was a free man who died for one that was a slave to sin. But in him, I have freedom. Not to be free and dumb, but to be free in his love. This was the price that he paid with his blood. It was the reconciliation of all creation back to the Father, the Creator, Abba, our Maker. And today we stand and see that he is risen, knowing that one day he will take us with him. And on that day, we'll be high, H-I-G-H, high, held in God's hands, high. Healed in God's hands, high. Home, home, home in God's heart, high. I don't know about you, but I feel alive, passed from death to life because he lives. He lives because he lives.
Good morning, church. I'm going to do that one more time. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Amen, amen. My name is Corey Johnson, one of the campus pastors here at Shelter Rock Church. And today we just want to welcome you to our Easter Sunday. Happy Easter Sunday, everyone. Awesome. One of the things that we believe here at Shelter Rock Church is that the church is not a place that you go to. It's a family that we belong to. Amen. And as we're gathered here from all the various campuses, from Westbury, from Syosset, from Manhasset, and even from online, we're here gathered together as a family to worship a risen King. Amen? But we're not only gathered here, but guess what? We're joining the families that's on Long Island, and we're joining the family of God that's in New York, and we're joining the family of God that's in North America. And guess what? We're joining the family of God that's all across the globe celebrating Resurrection Sunday this morning. Amen? And so we have hope. And so if you will you bow your heads with me as we pray? Father, we glorify your matchless name this morning. Indeed, you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And this morning, God, we glorify you because truly you are worthy to be praised. Father God, over 2,000 years ago, you sent your son Jesus Christ to die on the cross one sad Friday night. But God, 3 days later, God, he rose again from the grave, not only to conquer death, hell, and the grave, but he rose again to give us life and life eternal. And that is why we're here this morning, God, to exalt and to worship a risen King. And because you live this morning, Lord, we can live. And because you live, we can face tomorrow. And because you live, we can glorify your name. And this morning, God, as we're gathered together as a family, we just want to worship you because of who you are. Father God, we tell you thanks for what you will do and what you're about to do through us and in us. We tell you thanks. In Jesus' name we pray. Come on, let the family of God lift their voices and worship him this morning. Come on, lift your voices and worship him this morning. Hallelujah. We thank you. We thank you, Jesus. At this time, we ask you to continue standing as we continue to worship our risen Savior. God bless you.
I see first. has led.
Philosophy, not because of a good person, not even because of a good religion. We gather here today not as remembrance and memorial around our leader who is dead and gone. We are here today in celebration because Jesus is alive. We're so glad to be celebrating, so glad that you are celebrating here with us as well. The lights are going to come up just a little bit, and we want you to look around and greet those around you and welcome them to the celebration as well. And then you may be seated.
Thank you. Thank you, Pastor Leslie, for those words of encouragement on Resurrection Day. Pastor Leslie is the pastor over our family ministries over all of our campuses. My name is Jim Owens. I'm the campus pastor at Manhasset, and I want to welcome you. I want to thank you for being here. I want to welcome you from Manhasset, from Syosset, from Westbury, from our Spanish congregation, from our online congregation. Everyone here in one place for the first time in 3 years. It is super exciting to be here with you. And I want to just bring out a couple things. You were all given one of these bulletins as you walked in. And there's a couple things I want to bring your attention to. One is there's a Connect card on here. And I want you to fill this out and just let us know that you're here, especially if you're new. Maybe it's your first time coming to church. Maybe it's your first time at Shelter Rock. We would love to know that you are here. So just fill this out at the end of our service. We'll be collecting those. So we would love to get some information so we can help you get connected with God and help you get connected with others. We've got a lot of stuff happening here at our church, and we would love to help you. Now you're wondering, like, hey, how can I fill this out? I don't have a pen. You should have got a pen, all right? You got a pen, but this is no ordinary pen. This is the 80th anniversary pen. Now, you want to keep this. Years and years from now, these are going to be selling big time on eBay, all right? So keep these in your home. Now, the last thing I want to bring your attention to is there's a little square card on here, and it is a sermon series that we're going to be going through starting next Sunday at all of our campuses. It's called The God Who Renews. We all want a renewed life. We want to all want to have a like today is Resurrection Day. It's like something that came from the dead and it is resurrected. It is new. And God's promises through the book of Exodus, which we're going through the whole year, talks about renewal. And so we want to encourage you, bring a friend and come for our series called The God Who Renews. Put this on your refrigerator so you're reminded of what's going to be happening each week. Well, I want to thank you again for coming, and Pastor Leslie is going to continue our time of worshiping by giving us our scripture for today.
Amen. Would you join me, church, in standing as we continue now in a time of worship and celebration? You know, today more than ever, we have a reason to sing. We have a reason to celebrate. The Apostle Paul writes in 1 Corinthians, he wrote, "Death has been swallowed up in victory." It's been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? But thanks be to God. Thanks be to God. He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. You know, he's the one who we gather today to exalt. We're not here to lift up the name of Shelter Rock Church. We're not here to lift up the name of a pastor. We're here to lift up the name of the risen Savior, our Lord Jesus Christ. That is why we are here today. That is why we sing. That is why we celebrate. Would you close your eyes and in prayer with me? Jesus, we are here today. We want to see you lifted up. We want to see you exalted. The name that is above every name. The name that has no equal, no comparison. Jesus, we're here for you. May you take your place. May we honor you and celebrate you. For you alone are victorious. Because of you, we have life. Because of you, we have hope. Because of you, we have freedom. Thank you, Jesus. We pray all of this in your name.
Forever under your let's just begin to praise Him in this place. God, You're worthy. You are so worthy of worship. You are the God who rolled the stone away. Come on, church, let's worship the God who rolled the stone away. Your name. Come on, He's not in the grave. Come on.
damos gracias, Señor. Te damos gracias por lo que has hecho por nosotros en la cruz del Calvario, Señor. Por derramar tu sangre por nosotros, Señor, pecadores. Y a través de tus sacrificios que podemos tener vida eterna, Señor. We thank you for what you have done, God. We thank you for your sacrifice for us sinners, Father God. Because of what you've done is that we can live today, tomorrow, and forevermore, Father God. And today we give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. And the church says, amen.
You can go ahead and have a seat as we continue the service.
My name is Alice Dolan, and I was born in Brooklyn, New York, and we moved out here when I was 5 years old, so I've been a Long Islander pretty much my whole life. I was raised in an Episcopalian church. Both my parents were brought up Episcopalian. Actually, my grandfather's family had 5 Episcopalian ministers in his family. As I look back, I see that even though I was attending these services, I wasn't connecting. I don't think I was doing it just to say I went to church. I really felt like I was, you know, doing something meaningful, but I did not have a connection with God, a one-on-one connection, not nearly to the level that I do today. I would say that when my life did start to get very difficult through initially with a divorce, I did not know who to turn to. He was there. I know he was there. He was probably sitting there waiting for me to ask for him. And so even all those church services I went to, I just never focused on my own personal relationship with him. And it ended up, years of a very hard time. I've been through a few sort of journeys, I guess you could say. I mean, I had my divorce, which was very, very difficult. So I started doing a lot of I'm a very spiritually minded person. So I was doing things like meditation and yoga and, you know, all of these wonderful things that help with the calming. And it just wasn't enough. I just still felt this emptiness. I felt a lot of guilt and shame. You know, I just had this empty pit of yearning that I needed something more. I needed, I didn't know what it was. And it's actually, you know, funny. So then I ran into somebody who I didn't really know. And I just felt it was absolutely a God moment. I felt comfortable enough to say to basically a stranger that I feel depressed and I'm looking for something more. And his response was, "Have you ever heard of Alpha?" And that started this journey that I've been on. To me, now Easter is, I've always loved Easter. It's always been my most favorite Christian celebration. But Easter definitely has a whole new, I'm getting chills right now. I can't wait. What does the resurrection mean to me? It means that there's the proof. You know, all these years, thousands of years of people telling stories, the first things being prophesized about, you know, what was going to happen. And then, you know, these multiple firsthand accounts of the stories and the miracles of Jesus, and still people didn't believe, you know. And I guess, you know, you can sort of understand that. And to me, that's just the proof. I mean, you can't get more, you know, pretty any clearer than that. 3 days after his death, he's risen from the grave. And, and then still walked among us, which was even more amazing. So look at me, I just like lighten up. I think, you know, when things seem bleak, this is the kind of thing I want to share to others, is that, you know, when you're feeling down and you feel like there's no way out, there is a way out, because look at what he did. I mean, look at the way out that he did and what he showed and what he did for us, that all of that suffering. God sent him down to in human form. It's really God in human form, and he knows what it's like for us to suffer. And, it's really just a beautiful, beautiful moment when you realize that, you know, there is a way out, and it's through God, for sure.
Amen. We want to thank Alice Dolan for sharing her story with us today. And we want to thank you and welcome you here to Shelter Rock Church, our LIU post campus for the day, okay? We're really glad to have you here with us as we remember and celebrate all that God has done for us in Jesus Christ.
You know, it's been 4 years since we gathered together here as a church family. So this is really special to be here with one another. But even beyond that, for us, the reason I love Easter Sunday, the reason I love this weekend, is because this really is the weekend that changed the world. And it's this weekend that we remember that God did for us what we could not do for ourselves. That Jesus Christ indeed was dead. He was buried. And on the third day, he raised again. Amen? Amen. 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 You can clap it up for that, by the way. That's okay. That's good news. If we haven't met yet, my name is Henry, and I'm one of our pastors on staff. And today, we're going to talk for a few moments about what does it mean to believe in the resurrection story. I'm nearly certain in a room this size, people coming from different backgrounds and faith traditions or experiences or perspectives, that not everyone here is someone who believes. And yet, there are others of us who would say we believe. And yet the question is, do we really believe in a way that it changes and transforms our hearts and our lives as the risen Jesus intends? What does it mean to believe in the resurrection? What does it mean to believe in the gospel, the good news of what Christ has done? I was about 16 years old when someone explained this word to me for the very first time. And they told me the story of a man by the name of, Charles Blondin. I blanked on it for a moment. But Charles Blondin is one of the greatest tightrope walkers the world had ever known. Here's a picture of Charles Blondin tightroping across Niagara Falls, the first person to ever do it in 1859. He did this. He set up a tightrope 1,100 feet in the air above the raging waters of the falls. The distance from one end to the other was about 200 feet. And he announced it to everyone that this is what he was going to do. And because he didn't like to plan for the worst, because he thought if you plan for the worst just might happen, he always did a tightrope without a safety net and without a harness. And so in June of 1859, 100,000 people came to Niagara Falls to watch the great Blondin, as he was known, to walk from one side over to the other. I'm sure there were several of them who came to watch him plunge into his death and to fall, right? But this is not what happened, because when they came that day, he started off on one side, and as the crowd watched, he began to walk. And he walked slowly and deliberately, one foot in front of the other, all the way across to the other side. And the crowd went wild. And people started to cheer. You're amazing. You're amazing. You're incredible. And he's like, oh, yeah, yeah. You thought that was good. Let me do something a little better. And he blindfolded himself. And he said, do you believe I can make it across to the other side blindfolded? And they said, we believe. We believe. And so he did it. He blindfolded himself. And wouldn't you know it? He walked across 200 feet over the falls all the way to the other side. The crowd went wild. He said, you thought that was good. I'm going to do one better. At one point, he walked all the way across on stilts. Another time, he went across on a bicycle. One time, reports say, he carried a backpack on his back, went all the way to the middle of Niagara Falls on the tightrope, took off the backpack, set up an oven, and began to cook an egg. And then on one occasion, he decided to take a wheelbarrow. Now, you can see wheelbarrow technology has changed over the years if you look at this image, but this is a photograph of him saying, do you want to watch me go in the wheelbarrow across to the other side? And he asked the crowd, do you think I can make it to the other side pushing this wheelbarrow across? And they said, we believe, you're amazing, you can do it. And he said, okay, well, watch this. And he walked all the way across from one side to the other. And you can imagine, the crowd went wild. They went wild. They're like, you're amazing, you're amazing. He said, okay, you thought that was good. He took a 40-pound sack of potatoes, put it in the wheelbarrow. And he said, do you believe I can carry these potatoes from one side to the other? And the crowd went wild. We believe, we believe. He said, okay, watch this. So they're shouting, they're cheering, and sure enough, 40 pounds of potatoes all the way across to the other side. And the crowd went wild. And then he said, you thought that was good. So he takes out the potatoes, puts them down, and he looks out at the vast crowd. Do you believe I can take a human being in this wheelbarrow and push them across to the other side? And they shouted, we believe, you're amazing, we believe. He said, okay, good, 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 good. You who believe that I can take a human being to the other side, you get in the wheelbarrow. And no one did. Belief in the Bible is never a noun, it's always a verb. What does it mean to believe? What does it mean to have faith? It's not just about merely intellectually assenting to something and saying, I ascribe to these sets of beliefs. I believe this is true. No, no. Belief in the Bible, belief in the New Testament is so much more than head knowledge. It actually impacts the way we live. It moves us from head to heart, to hands and feet. It's an active response and an active obedience to God. This is what it means to believe. Paul is writing to a church in Corinth, and their beliefs are skewed. They believed in the resurrection of Jesus, but they didn't really understand that his resurrection was going to have an impact on their resurrection one day. And so he writes a letter to this church, and in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and this is the passage we're going to read today. Spend a few minutes unpacking it. It's the greatest chapter in the Bible on the resurrection of Jesus. Paul goes through a full, long discourse on what the resurrection means and what does it mean to believe that God raised Jesus from the dead. And he writes to the church, and God is saying to us today these words. Read along with me. Paul says, "For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance." That's foundational importance. It's at the bedrock of our faith. "That Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures." Notice, first of all, Christ died for our sins. He was buried. That's in the past tense. Someone else buried him. And then significantly, he said, he was raised again. In other words, God raised Jesus from the dead. And the reason Paul says he knows this is because in verse 5, he says, "And that he appeared to Cephas and then to the 12. And after that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time. Most of them are still living, though some have fallen asleep." Most scholars say Paul wrote this letter in the year 52-53 AD. Some of the people who saw the risen Jesus and met the risen Lord are still alive. So if you're wondering about this, he's saying to his hearers, go and ask them. Go and find them. Here are their names. Here's who they are. And then verse 7, Paul says, "Then he appeared to James, and then to the apostles. And last of all, he appeared to me." Paul says Christ died for our sins, was buried, was raised again, and then he started appearing to others to make himself known. And he did it to Cephas, to the 12, to many at one time, to the apostles, to James, and he even lastly appeared to me. And this is our hope today. Not that we would just gather and sing some songs and celebrate and go enjoy a nice meal later, but that we would have an encounter with our living God, with the risen Savior, who longs to show himself to you and to me. A couple things I want to show you today. First of all, we're going to look at what Jesus has done for us. What Jesus has done for us. The gospel is good news. It's not good advice, right? The resurrection, we remember today what Jesus has done for us. And then secondly, we're going to see how Jesus comes to us. How Jesus makes his way and appears to you and to me. First, what Jesus does for us. Three things. First of all, Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. See, Jesus' death on Good Friday was not just Jesus' death. It was actually Jesus' death in substitution for you and for me. That there was something happening on the cross, that God came down in Christ, lived the life we could not live, and then died the death we deserve in our place. He died for our sins, which is why Peter says in 1 Peter 2, he bore our sins on his body on the tree. Christ died for our sins. The story begins on Good Friday. And that was the first day. And then it goes to the second day. And then he was buried. That's day two. He was buried, and he was in the tomb on Saturday, and he was dead. He was really dead. The Romans knew how to kill people. They were experts at crucifixion. It's a historical fact that Jesus Christ of Nazareth was crucified by the Romans and was placed in a tomb. Non-biblical scholars, atheists, agnostics, everyone, historians acknowledge that is historically factual. Christ died, and then he was buried. And then on the third day, God raised him from the dead. Do you ever wonder why God did it on the third day? I mean, Jesus could have died on Good Friday and moments later, resurrection, in front of everybody, in front of the Romans, in front of the people throwing the nails in his hand and everything. He could have done it on the first day. God could have done it on the second day. It could have been Saturday. Next day, you wake up, boom, he's there. Wow. God could have waited to the fourth day. Or the fifth day. I asked my kids this morning, I said, why do you think God waited to the third day? My son said, well, he likes to build up anticipation, you know? Maybe so, but you wait day four, day five. Wow. Why the third day? It says he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. Now, I'm just going to spend a moment here, but I want you to know that the third day is significant. Because in the Bible, we see a pattern of God doing surprising things on the third day. God doing miraculous things on the third day. God doing redemptive things on the third day. God doing resurrection things on the third day. You see this pattern all throughout the Bible. I'm going to name just a few of them for you. In Genesis chapter 1, God created the heavens and the earth. And you know what? The land was dry, and there was no vegetation and no fruit and no vegetables. It was totally lifeless. And then on the third day, God caused vegetables to sprout out from the ground. New life on the third day. You go to Genesis chapter 22. Abraham is told to go up to the mountain and sacrifice his son on the mountain. He doesn't really understand, but he has hope in the resurrection. The writer of Hebrews tells us that. He goes up on the mountain, and it's a long journey, and we're told on the third day, he lays his son on the altar. The angel intervenes, and he gets his son back. God does something new on the third day. Later in the book of Genesis, a man named Joseph is in prison. He gets released. Guess what day it is? Oh, you're good. Third day, Joseph gets released. I wrote a list of them. I got 16 of them. I'm not going to share all of them. But you know, when God showed down up on Mount Sinai and he appeared in Exodus 19 and made a covenant with his people, he told them to wait and to fast and to pray. But then on the third day, he came down to be with them. Ruth meets her kinsman redeemer, Boaz. You know when she met him? On the third day. All throughout the Bible, on the third day. Hezekiah is given 15 extra years of life on the third day. Jonah spent how many days in the belly of the fish? 3 days, and was emerged on the third day. I love when Jesus gets to the New Testament, he builds on this theme. He's at a wedding. It's his first miracle, first sign. He takes water, and he turns it into, you know what day it was? It was the third day. The third day is a pattern we see throughout the Bible, a pattern that emerges of God doing new things. The third day is like new wine. The third day is like the first day of a new creation. And when Jesus is raised from the dead, what Paul is saying, he's saying he was raised and it was done on the third day. The third day has come finally and fully in the person of Jesus, and you and I are invited to belong to it. So if you're here and it's your first day or it's your second day and things are confusing or disorienting and you're not sure who God is or what's going on or what good could come out of where you are today, just hear the word of the gospel. The third day has come. God has raised Christ from the grave. And he wants you to know him. He wants you to encounter him for yourself, you and me both. And the way we know this is because Jesus, the living Jesus, the risen Jesus, goes out of his way to appear to his disciples so that they might know him and experience the transformation that comes from being with him. Jesus appeared on the third day. And this is one way where Jesus and I are pretty different. I'll just be honest with you, okay? Jesus and I are very different in a number of ways. My wife's here, she'll tell you, okay? If I were raised from the dead, and I had just been betrayed, and I had just been crucified, and I had just been mocked, and they put a crown of thorns on my head, and they put a purple robe on my back, if the chief priest, if Caiaphas, if the Sadducees, if the Pharisees, if the Roman guards, Pilate washing his hands of me, if I was raised from the dead, you know who I would have went to first? I would have went right into Pilate's bedroom in the middle of the night and be like, hey man, what's going on? I'm back, right? You tried to get me, you couldn't get me. Go to the Jewish leaders, go to the scribes, go to the Pharisees. Like, show up with some sort of like retaliatory message to show them that they can't hold me down. Jesus is different. This is Jesus' heart for us. And he wants us to know him. He wants us to experience his love for us and the transformation that comes from being with him, which is why he shows up to these people. He shows up to Cephas. That's the Aramaic name for Peter. Peter, the last time we read about it in the Gospels, deny Jesus. It's the last time we hear of him. He denied Jesus not once, not twice, but three times. But it's the third day. So Jesus shows up to Peter and offers him forgiveness from his sin and his guilt and his shame. And he forgives him and he empowers him. And he says, I've got a job for you to do. And Peter goes on to lead the early church because it's the third day. He shows up to the 12. These 12 disciples, they were scattered. They were afraid. They were filled with fear. They were worried that the Romans were going to come for them. This is what they did to their leader. What are they going to do to us? So they weren't with Mary and Mary Magdalene and Salome and others around the cross. They were scattered, hiding at home. Jesus comes to them. Why? Because it's the third day. And he says, perfect love casts out all fear. You don't need to be afraid. I'm with you now. And he gives him a job. And all of these guys who are filled with fear end up being filled with boldness and courage. And they end up, many of them, laying down their lives for Jesus. Why? Because they met the risen Lord on the third day. After that, he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters. I love this. Jesus, he'll appear to big crowds, but he also takes the time for the one-on-one personal encounter. And then he appears to James, the text says. James is an interesting one, isn't it? There's a couple James, if you've seen The Chosen, that walk with Jesus. You've got James and John, the sons of Zebedee, but then you've got James the Less, right? But this James is neither one of those two Jameses. This is the third James. This is James, the half-brother of Jesus, who was skeptical about Jesus, who in Mark 3 tried to get Jesus captured by the authorities, who in John 7 said his brother was a lunatic. This is that James, who ended up becoming a leader in the early church. What happened? What was different? Paul tells us he's different because he met the risen Jesus. Then he appears to all the apostles, and we don't know exactly who all of the apostles are, but we do know who's numbered among the apostles, and the first of the apostles was a woman named Mary. You know Mary? She's going to the tomb on the third day, and her heart is heavy, and her eyes are filled with tears. And she's going to anoint the body of Jesus, but she gets there, and he's not there, and she's panicking. She's filled with fear. She turns around. She sees a man standing there, and the Bible says she thought he was the gardener. And it was the right mistake to make, because he is the gardener of a new creation. And he calls out her name. Remember? Mary. Mary. And her tears are turned to joy because the risen Jesus met her on the third day. So Paul goes through these. The risen Jesus appeared to Cephas and the 12 and more than 500. Then he appeared to James, then to the apostles. And last of all, he says, he appeared to me. Now, who was Paul? Well, his name was Saul of Tarsus, and he was an enemy of the Christian faith. In fact, he was trying to eradicate the Christian faith. He was on his way to Damascus with papers to be able to arrest and execute Christians, to squash this movement. And yet a bright light shined out of the sky. He was blinded. He fell to the ground. And yet, as Pastor CJ said earlier, he was blinded in that moment, but finally he could see. The risen Jesus appeared to him. And I believe today the risen Jesus longs to appear to you. He appeared to me when I was about 16 years old. I grew up in the church. I would attend Easter services. I knew the Bible. I was in Sunday school. I grew up in Staten Island in the church. It was familiar to me, but I was one way on Sunday, and the rest of the week, I was fairly indistinguishable from the rest of my friends because I had Jesus in my head, but I didn't have him in my heart. And he was yet to impact the way I lived my life. I said I believed, but nothing really changed in the way I lived until one day, alone in my bedroom, I can't even explain it, God got a hold of my heart. And I could see myself as I really was, a sinner in need of a Savior. And I cried out to Jesus to save me. And you know what? I got something back. And he did. And he transformed me. And he is transforming me today. And he longs to do that for you as well. It was Andrew Murray who said, "A dead Christ, I have to do everything for. But a living Christ does everything for me." He is alive. He is alive. He is alive. And he longs to reveal himself to you on this third day. So what about you? How will you respond to the risen Jesus? Do you believe? Do you believe? I know you've gone to church. I know you're here on Sunday. I know you're making it a part of your plans. Do you believe? Do you believe that Jesus can take you not just across Niagara Falls, 200 feet in the air? Do you believe that Jesus can take you from here into eternity, into the presence of God? Do you believe that he can wash away your sins today? Do you believe that he can separate them, as the Bible says, as far as the east is from the west? Do you believe he can do that? You say, "Pastor, you don't know what I've done. You don't know the shame. You don't know the guilt. You don't know the regret. You have no idea what I've done." You're right. But I know my Jesus. And I know he can wash away every sin if we but call on his name and ask him to do it. You say, "Well, I got so much guilt and so much shame." I say, give it to Jesus. You say, "I got so many bad habits, so many addictions, so much brokenness." I say, give it to Jesus. You say, "I got sorrow, I got pain, I got hurt." I say, give it to Jesus. Give it to Jesus. You know why? Because it's the third day, church. Sorry. I don't have a service after this, so I can just keep on going, okay? It's the third day. It's the third day. It's the third day. Do you believe? Do you believe? Do you believe? And if you believe, then get in.
Hi, guys. My name is Nathaniel Lau, but you can call me Nate. I grew up in New York, Long Island, Garden City. I'm currently a sophomore in college, attending St. John's, but it wasn't always like that. As a freshman, I was going to Baylor University in Texas. But long story short, I got suspended. I started kind of hanging out with the wrong people, doing things I shouldn't have been doing. I was kind of partying almost every single day. I'd probably tried every single substance that there was to try in college. Been caught multiple times. I would never go to my meetings to kind of explain myself, to face the consequences, and a big consequence hit me. And for me, that was the first kind of rude awakening that I ever had in my life, because at the moment, I loved my life. But in the Bible, it says the heart is deceitful and desperately wicked, which my heart definitely was at the time. I always grew up in the church, but as I would put it, I always wore my Christianity around my sleeve, but I never imprinted it on my heart. I kind of told myself, like, "Nate, it's time to change." And I didn't want this life for myself anymore. And when I came back, I kind of broke down in front of my parents. They were able to see that I repented kind of for my ways, and I was kind of broken about the sins I had committed. And at that point, God had started to kind of nurture the seed that he'd planted in me many, many years ago when I first came to church as a kid. I had a whole semester to myself because I'd gotten suspended. My parents told me to get a job, and they told me that I should come to Shelter Rock Church and try out some of the small groups. I spent my whole year doing the opposite of things, going to church. So, you know, why don't I try it? I started coming to the Alpha Group on Wednesdays at the Manhasset campus, and even at that point, you know, God hadn't totally shifted my heart. I started to go on with my life. You know, I was still kind of in some of my old habits, trying to fill this God-shaped hole in my heart with everything but God. But slowly, he brought me to different things. It was almost as if every time I would kind of want to go back into that lifestyle or kind of fall off the cliff, as I say it, he would stop me and then reel me back in with his love, which is what happened. I had this dinner one night with my parents, my grandparents, and this elderly couple from my grandparents' church. What happened that night, I did not expect. At that point, God had really begun to work in my heart. So I had a lot of questions, and when they did answer, the answers were so profound. When he mentioned the love of Christ, I started to well up, and then I just started to burst into tears. And for the first time in my life, that happened. I'd never done that before. I was never really a crier. You know, I always kept to myself about my emotions, but I couldn't even hold it back. As much as I tried to keep it down, it kind of welled up in me. And this only happened, I'd say, about a month and a half ago. But ever since then, I think my life has truly been different. You know, the people around me have told me that they see a change in me. I've been able to encourage others, and I've been able to get rid of a lot of my temptations. I say one thing that I always struggled with was substance use, but ever since that day, God completely took away my substance abuse problems. So one thing I will say is give your worries to God, surrender them to God, for he's the only one that can truly take them away from you. A lot of people, I think nowadays, they have this big hole in their heart. You know, they try to fill it with different things, you know, whether it's money, riches, girls, guys, substances, pretty much things of this world. And one thing I noticed is that no matter how many of these things you keep putting into yourself, you'll always need it again. When I finally was able to encounter God, I realized that this is the only thing I need.
Hi, everyone. My name is Jerry O'Sullivan, the Syosset campus pastor. Yeah. Thank you. And I have a question for you. Would you agree that the hope of the resurrection is good news? Would you agree? Going from death to life is good news. And when we receive good news, when we hear good news, we need to respond. And church, this is your moment to respond. Take out the papers, the card in your little bulletin, and just wave it so I know that you have them in your hand. Just wave. Come on. There you go. I'm seeing some cards. There we go. Thank you. So on the back of that card, or the Connect card, you'll see a couple things, a couple ways to respond. And if you have the 80th annual commemorative pen, great. But if you don't, of course, there's a QR code there for your phone. You could use that also for everything I'm going to talk about. So the first thing that says there is, let us know if you're newer. We would love to know if you're newer. You can check off that little box. Maybe your first or second time at Shelter Rock Church. We'd love to help you get connected. But then it talks about Alpha. And both Alice and Nate talked about Alpha. Alpha simply means beginning. And for most people here at Shelter Rock Church, that's the beginning of investigating a relationship with God. Alpha is a simple 10-week course that we host where you can get your questions answered about God. Some of the questions we ask and answer at Alpha are, who is Jesus? Why did Jesus have to die? How do I pray? How do I read the Bible? Who's the Holy Spirit? What does the Holy Spirit do? Those are the questions we go through each week. There's a short video teaching. There's discussion. But the best part is we feed you. We feed you a great meal. It's free. We come out. There's discussion. This year at Shelter Rock Church, we're offering Alpha in English, of course, but also in Spanish. and in Mandarin. So if you're interested, we'd love to know. So you're coming, so you can plan for the food. There's at the info tables outside. There's a little brochure you can check and register online, or the QR codes are on the signs in the foyer. Just let us know that you're coming. Where are my Alpha grads? Just raise your hand if you're an Alpha grad. You've been to Alpha. Just raise your hand up. Good. Alpha grads, your job is to invite someone. Invite someone out to Alpha. Come with them. You might even write their name right here. I'm going to invite Jerry. I was invited by a friend to church, believe it or not. And here's another response, another way to respond. Talk to someone about walking with Jesus. And I love this. Here at Shelter Rock Church, we're not about religion. We're about understanding a relationship with Jesus that you can talk to and hear from and be encouraged by. And if you'd like some more guidance, some more encouragement, some more wisdom, check that box and someone will respond to you and help you understand what that means. You know, in a few moments, we're going to receive our offering. And we also gave you another way to respond, that little envelope. A lot of purple people come to church and say, oh, church, all they want is my money. Well, the example that we have from God is that God is a giver. God the Father gave the Son. Jesus gave his life on a cross for us. The Holy Spirit was given to the church. The church is all about giving. And if you'd like to make a gift today, you can use the envelope there. There's also a QR code in the envelope that you can scan and give securely, digitally. When the baskets come by, you can put that in there. But there's another way to respond. We have our prayer team down here in the front. And if you'd like to be prayed for, prayed over, you have something going on in your life that's just, it's been nagging at you, discouraging you. When the baskets come by, once we all stand and the worship is playing, come down here to the front and the prayer team will pray for you. Let's worship God with our giving.
With me, he talks with me, tells me.
Church, can we invite you to stand up on your feet and worship with us? And we're going to sing on that old hymn. You know it already. Yes, Lord. He walks with me.
He walks with me. He talks with me. He tells me I am his own. The joy we share, what else comes?
Amen. Church, would you pray with me? Jesus, you said that a wise man builds his house on the rock, and whoever hears these words of mine and does them is like someone who builds their house on the rock. So this day, Lord, we're going to respond to you, your invitation for us to build our hearts and lives on you, Jesus, and in what you've done for us. I pray that if there's anybody here today, Lord, who does not yet know you, who's on the outside looking in, who's waiting and longing for the third day, that today would be the day of salvation. Friends, with every head bowed and every eye closed, if you're here today and you sense Jesus speaking to your heart, just know I believe that's just what he does. He's alive. He's speaking. Often we're not listening, but he's always speaking. He's inviting. He's welcoming. And if he's calling you today, I want to give you an opportunity to respond, just in the quiet of your own heart, to be able to say, yes, Jesus, come on in. Come on in, Jesus. Forgive me of my sins. Make me clean. Make me whole. Jesus, I want to bury my sins and experience new life in you. Friends, if you're here and that's the posture of your heart, that's a prayer you pray, just know that's a prayer God hears. And a prayer God responds to. And today is the first day of a new creation for you. Jesus, for the rest of us who are gathered here today, we don't want the routine of this day to be lost on us. We want to see the empty tomb with fresh eyes, with wonder, with amazement, with awe, and respond in worship. So Jesus, lead us. As we get in, Lord, lead us, guide us, direct us, move us as you wish. We give this time and we give this day to you. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said, amen. 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 Praise God. You know, our prayer teams are here. We're going to end in just a moment. I got a couple things we want to do first. But I do want to mention that our prayer teams are here. So if you prayed that prayer, or you've something else you're carrying and you want to give it to God, just know we're here for you. You don't have to rush out. We're not going anywhere. I think we're here, what time, 4 or 5 o'clock p.m., something like that. We got a breakdown. So we'll be here. We're not going anywhere. But come. God's speaking. This is your opportunity to respond. And I also, as you consider that, I want to invite Pastor Steve to come on out. And he's going to be coming out with his family. Can we welcome Pastor Steve and his family to the stage today? You know, you may not know this, but Pastor Steve joined our staff, was called by God to serve at our church back in, what year was it, Steve?
2002.
At the time when Pastor Steve came, Pastor Jack was the interim pastor of Shelter Rock Church. Jack passed Steve the baton, and a few years ago, Pastor Steve passed it to me. And this Sunday is Pastor Steve's last Sunday on staff at our church. God's calling him into a new season, a new opportunity. He and his family are moving to Nevada. It's not his last Sunday at Shelter Rock. I always tell him that. It's just his last Sunday on staff at our church. But Pastor Jack, I'm going to hand it over to you and Pastor Steve to tell us what's... Introduce your family, maybe.
Sure. I'll start with my beautiful wife, Michelle. And... next to her is my son, Aaron. Then my firstborn, Melody, and her new husband, Dan. My youngest is Tabitha, and in the middle is Faith. And you've heard me give so many illustrations about my mom. So I brought my mom here today, 93 years old.
So Steve, when you get out to your new place, you're just going to put out the lounge chair and basically just, relax for the rest of your life? Well, what's ahead for you?
I like to say I'm going to Shelter Rock West. You know, I will be in ministry there. And quite honestly, the Las Vegas area is like Main Street America. Come by, give me a call, we'll have lunch. Okay? But as Pastor Henry mentioned, he said, I'm welcome to come back and visit, and so you will see me not too long from now.
Steve, is there an on the border nearby?
There is one there. There is.
Well, listen, Steve, we want you to take something with you. You've been a great Bible teacher. You've been a real man of God's word, and it's made a big impact on people's life. And so Pastor Henry has for you a life application Bible with your name embossed on it. And what's inside of it is even more special, because for the last three Sundays, we've taken it to all the campuses, and we've said to people, why don't you just write a note to Pastor Steve and to his family, Michelle and everyone, and just tell them about a verse that they remember you preaching about, or a verse that they, you know, it made a change in their life. So that Bible is about twice as long as it used to be, okay? But it is loaded. Just hold it up there. Just load it up with all these tabs written by all these people, just expressing their appreciation to you.
Thank you, Pastor Jack. And you may not know, but Pastor Jack was a participant in making the notes for the Life Application Bible.
So, well, but I got a lot of co-writers here now. You see the notes that they wrote. So, can I pray for you?
Please.
Would you like to pray for them? Just put your hand out, okay? And let's just extend it to them. Father, Lord God Almighty, we thank you. We've been so blessed these past 20-plus years to have Pastor Steve and Michelle, their family, to be able to watch their children grow up, to have the heritage of his father and mother as part of our heritage. We thank you for the way that he has become a real student of your word. Thank you for the gifts that you've given him to be able to teach and preach. All of us have learned something. All of us have been stirred in our hearts. We thank you for that. We thank you for his generosity and the way that he built up not just our church, but he built up many other churches all around the New York area and around the world. We thank you, Father, for the way that he is always responsive to our needs and the way that you used him. So now, just as they go, I pray that you protect each member of the family, this new season in their life, open new doors to them, and bless them richly, as you always do. In Jesus' name, amen.
So it's my privilege to do the benediction here today. And what I would love for you to do, in a spirit of response, maybe put your hands out and receive these words. The Apostle Paul penned these words from both Ephesians chapter 1 and Ephesians chapter 3. And he said, and here is your blessing, I pray that the eyes of your heart would be opened, that you would be enlightened to see that the very power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead is available for you and I as believers. And he continues to pray that you would see how high, how deep, how wide, and how long is the love of Jesus Christ for every one of us here. And so now, Father, I pray that you would bless this congregation. But Lord, we recognize that we have been blessed. We have had that opportunity to taste and see that the Lord is good. And so, Lord, it is our desire that everything that we've done here today, every song that we sang, every word that was spoken, would ultimately contribute to the glory of your Son, Jesus Christ, because it is in his name we pray. And all God's people said really, really loud, amen. God bless you. God bless you. One more thing we need to do. He is risen.
Yes.
And he is risen indeed. You guys ready? Here we go.
Part of a great tradition that goes on all around the world. And as of right now, probably more than a billion people have said on this day, he is risen. And to which the response is, he's risen indeed. Pastor Steve and I have done this for a long time. Are you ready? Yeah. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed. Amen. God bless. I'll meet you in the foyer.